Morning, everybody. Today we are going to finish up Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. We're going to finish our final step back and get the perfect view here at that stained glass window that Paul has been putting together for all of the chapters up until now. And there's a lot going on in here. We're going to focus on just a couple of aspects in this, but it's just an amazing finish, I think, to an amazing chapter. All right, so let's go ahead and we'll begin. We'll dig right in. I'm going to read verses 31 through 36. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen, if it is God who justifies? Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Remember that verse, we'll be talking about that later. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. Okay, so in this first passage, this first portion of what we're looking at this morning, Paul asks seven questions. And these seven questions are in response to what we just finished talking about last week. This was Romans 8, 28 through 30. God working for the good of all those who love him or called according to his purpose. And we talked about predestination and justification and all of that. And so we have all of that that we talked about and focused on last week. And so the first of Paul's seven questions is, what shall we say in response to these things? What shall we say in response to everything that we talked about last week? Everything that's been building since we've started the book of Romans. His second question then is a very famous one. Gives us a lot of comfort. If God is for us, who can be against us? In light of God predestining us from the beginning of time to be able to spend an eternity in heaven, in light of God being all-powerful and all-knowing and all these things we know God to be, if that is the God who is guiding our steps to the destination, if that is our God who is taking care of us, who then can be against us? Of course, the answer is absolutely no one. And he's going to develop that concept out a little bit more, too, here in the next few verses. He starts here, actually. He says, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? And so the point here is that sometimes we've got a problem thinking about our relationship with God and kind of realizing we're not doing a very good job sometimes. We think, well, is God's grace going to continue to be sufficient for me? Is God going to really help me out in what I'm doing now? But then Paul says, look at what God has already done for you. Is he not going to continue and finish the work? If he's already sent his son to die on the cross for you, if you've already been justified, how much more can we be assured that God is going to continue to take care of us and continue to work with us? Number four, who will bring charges against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who can bring charges against us? We're going to talk more about some of the formality of this here in a minute, but he goes ahead and answers the question. He says, no one. And then he says, who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God, who is also interceding for us. And we're starting to see more and more of these little pictures coming together that's showing us almost a courtroom scene of us standing in judgment before God. And then he asks this all-important question, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? And so this is another question that we ask and then obviously is immediately answered, but there's actually some interesting stuff going on in this question. When he says, who shall separate us? That word separate, this is the same word that shows up in Matthew 19:6, which talks about marriage. And read that to you in the King James, because that's how most of us remember this for some reason. What therefore God hath joined together, let no man put asunder. The same thing. Who can do that? Who can separate us from the love of Christ? Who can pull us asunder? And of course, the answer is no one. But he's asking the question, who? But he's really personifying, because in the next statement, he's going to go over the things which could challenge us, and he's not talking about people. So it's interesting the way that he personifies these troubles or these hardships in our lives, but this is exactly what he says. Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? That's the who. As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. So he asks us these seven questions, and I think each of these seven questions could be fine for an entire Sunday morning, or maybe more than one Sunday morning, but we're not going to dive too deeply into any of these today. Instead, what I want us to look at here is kind of this courtroom scene that's being presented for us. And as we've been working through Romans, and even in some other books, we've seen it's common for the authors of the Bible to use terminology that's legal terminology. And if we start piecing together these different legal terms, we can maybe get a better view into our relationship with God or our situation by imagining a courtroom scene playing out and looking at all these different pieces of legal metaphors and legal terms when they all kind of come together into this place. So we'll go ahead and we'll plot out our courtroom scene, and we will see we'll see how this plays out. And just to caveat this, it's not a perfect metaphor, right? It doesn't hold together 100%. We're piecing together different legal terms from the Bible, but the principle that we're going to get at, I think, is pretty accurate. So first, we'll imagine a courtroom like today, a modern courtroom. What does that look like? And we've all seen TV and movie depictions of court. And so we know at the front of the room, the head, kind of the center of your courtroom, there's going to be a judge, right? He or she is going to be sitting in this sort of raised desk or platform or whatever, and they've got the gavel and all of that. So that's at the head of the room is the judge. And in front of and facing the judge to his left, or the right side of the courtroom, we have the defense attorney. Right, and the defense attorney's at a table, and there could be a team of people. The defendant may be there for part of the case, right? And to the defense attorney's left, also facing the judge, we have the prosecuting attorney. And so all the courtroom drama and antics all play out with this as kind of the setting. To the judge's left, there's a chair or a seat, and the person who's being questioned or cross-examined or whatever, that's your witness stand there, right there up here on the screen. And since we're picturing our own judgment, we can imagine this would be us taking the stand, right? Being accused, being cross-examined, being defended, being judged. This is you on this stand. This is me on this stand. And over here on the right side of the courtroom, kind of on benches, I think, there is the jury. So this is what our courtroom looks like or is laid out as today, as I understand it. Now, here we can start placing some of our Bible images using legal terminology into our courtroom. What the Bible shows us or tells us is that in our court drama that plays out spiritually, the prosecuting attorney is actually Satan himself. Revelation chapter 12, verse 10. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, "Now have come the salvation and the power of the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Messiah. For the accuser," here he is, "of our brothers and sisters, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down." Now that passage is talking about something else, a bit of prophecy, but what it shows us is a picture of Satan himself as our accuser, making accusations about us to God day and night. And so here, you know, again, our caveat, not a perfect metaphor because some of these things in the courtroom play out at different times, eschatologically speaking, just trying to show a concept here. But what we've got is we have this picture of Satan himself in heaven talking to God and pointing right down at us. See what he did just right there? You see that? I told you he was going to do that. Right? Watch what this guy's going to do next. He's accusing us day and night, the Bible says. Right? But verse 34 of Romans chapter 8 that we just read, who is it who condemns? And Paul said, no one. The important thing to recognize or understand here is that Satan may accuse, but he does not have the power to condemn. All right, so if there's this celestial being or an angel that's just accusing us but doesn't have the power to actually condemn us, we can ask the question, does it really matter? Is this really a problem that Satan is here in this position doing this thing? And the answer is it kind of doesn't matter because it's already a done deal that he's not going to be effective at it. But it kind of does matter too. If we were to imagine illustration to illustrate our illustration, you might have you remember back to when you were a kid, or, you know, I can remember when I was a kid, maybe in, I don't know, we'll say third grade, and maybe I brought a toy to class when I wasn't supposed to, and I was maybe playing with it, hypothetically speaking, at my desk where, you know, I thought the teacher couldn't see, and maybe the teacher did see me, and I kind of realized I got caught maybe, and so I quickly put the toy away, and the teacher didn't say anything, and I didn't say anything, but little Stevie Thomas raised his hand and says, teacher, Tim is playing with this toy he's not supposed to have, right? He accuses, he is not able to condemn, but the situation suddenly becomes more uncomfortable. He's calling out me, he's calling out the teacher, and he's really saying, where is this justice that is supposed to occur in this room? Right? That's essentially what he's doing. The situation gets exacerbated. And so here we have this celestial being doing this day in and day out. And so I would suggest this is indeed a problem. That is the prosecuting attorney, Satan himself. Fortunately for us, though, we do have a defense attorney, and we have a very good defense attorney. And the Bible says that defense attorney is none other than Jesus himself. 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. And we talked about this word a few weeks ago when we were looking at, I don't even remember what which part of Romans, but I think it's even still in Romans chapter 8. We dug into this word advocate. It's the Greek word paraclete. And like I said earlier in chapter 8, we were looking at this word because this word was used to talk about some of the functions of the Holy Spirit. And when we worked through that, we also looked at John chapter 14, 15, which famously in the King James translated this as comforter. So if you remember that discussion that we had, we're not going to dig too much into the Greek this morning because we already did that. But just to remind us here what that word paraclete means, this role that is the Holy Spirit, this role that we just read is Jesus' role for us, one of the roles. It means one who is called to the side of another. And it's for the purpose, really, of helping out in any and every way, but especially with regards to legal proceedings and criminal charges. All right, so we've got this picture of Jesus as our defense attorney, and so the way this would work out is we've got him arguing before the judge, defending us. All right, that's Jesus' role, one of Jesus' roles in the courtroom scene, playing out. Jesus arguing on our behalf, interceding for us, being our advocate, and Satan accusing us before God day and night. Now, what's peculiar, what we have to recognize about our courtroom scene here that's a little different than what we're used to seeing is that in our spiritual or heavenly courtroom that the Bible pieces together for us, there is no jury of our peers. We have to take that off the table. I, for one, I'm kind of glad about that because honestly, if you know, there's this argument going on with being accused and being defended, and then it came up to, you know, a group of my peers and having deciding which way things should go, I'm never going to have 100% confidence that things are going to turn out right. I mean, courts get it wrong sometimes. Usually they don't, we think, but it can be wrong. But no, that's not how this is decided. Our courtroom scene in the Bible shows that the judge is the one who decides the outcome. Right, the judge is the one who determines whether it is a guilty or innocent verdict. It is the judge who sentences. It is entirely up to the judge. And in our courtroom scene in the Bible, this is amazing, when it talks about who our judge is, our judge is actually Jesus. Jesus is the judge, right? And so here, kind of, again, our metaphor breaks down a little bit, in all fairness. We've got a very clear picture in the Bible that every single person in the world who dies is going to face judgment, right? That's the fate of all of us, every single person. That is absolutely unavoidable. But the Bible talks about there being different judgments, right? So it's not like everybody shows up to the same judgment and then some people are let out of door A and some people are let out of door B and, you know, one group goes to heaven, one group goes to hell. It's not like that. Actually, the Bible suggests that there are individual judgments, and you only go to the one where your outcome is predetermined to go that way. So one of the judgments is the great white throne judgment, and that is the judgment that everyone who never made Jesus their Savior will go to someday, and there they will be pronounced guilty, and they will be cast into the lake of everlasting fire. It is not a place you want to be at all. So that is one judgment. And again, everybody who goes there, that's going to be the result. The other judgment, the one that we're concerned with here this morning, is called the Bema Seat of Christ. And there's a picture of this in Romans chapter 14, verse 10, and 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9. And the word Bema in the Greek literally means judgment seat. But this is where our metaphor is maybe great, maybe not so great, I don't know. It's a judgment seat, literally, but not so much a judge like a judge in a courtroom. This is more of a judge like in the ancient Olympic Games, right? So a judge at that time would sit on a bema seat, and he would be placed right at the finish line where a race would be run. And so the judge would be right there to see who crosses the line first, and the judge would declare them the winner. We talked about this concept back when we worked through 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, I believe it was, but that was a little while ago. And we said that it is at that Bema Seat judgment where those who cross the line, those who are judged there, will receive a Stephanos, or a victor's crown. All right? So this is the Bema Seat of Christ. This is the place that you will be judged if you've made Jesus your Savior. You'll receive your victor's crown, and this is the place where you will finally hear your Savior say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." An amazing, amazing thing that we're promised, this little snapshot of what's going to happen. It's going to be an absolutely incredible time. So because this is more of a judgment, like for a game rather than a courtroom, it kind of doesn't work perfectly for our courtroom metaphor, but maybe it kind of does, because I think what this shows us is that if you've made Jesus your Savior, you're going to be judged. You're going to have a courtroom event play out for you. But it's not going to be a court that's been convened to sentence you or to convict you. It's going to be a court that is convened to crown us with victory, even with Satan sitting right there calling us out, accusing us before God day in and day out. It's an incredible, incredible picture that gets laid out for us here of this courtroom drama. Now, there's a couple of implications coming out of this that I think are worth exploring as well. The first is, we can talk about conflicts of interest with this whole arrangement, right? As a Christian, this is a wonderful, wonderful arrangement for us. In a secular court, a worldly court today, there is no way that anybody would let an arrangement like this stand, because it's just loaded with conflicts of interest, right? We can imagine in a court of law, if a judge is going to preside over a trial and they figure out who the attorneys are, and I don't know when that gets determined or any of that, but if the judge and one of the attorneys has a special relationship, like it's their brother-in-law or you know, something like that, a best friend or whatever, then either the judge would need to recuse himself or the attorney would need to be changed or something like that, because you can't have a conflict of interest. There's no way a judge could be impartial if they have a strong personal relationship with one of the attorneys. I think that makes sense, right? But here in the picture of our courtroom scene that's playing out, it's not that the judge and one of the attorneys has a special relationship. It's that the judge and our defense attorney are the exact same person. There is no way that impartiality could take place here. The judge is going to be heavily biased because the judge is the one who's defending us. This is a wonderful, wonderful arrangement for us, but in a modern court like in our county or our state or whatever, this would be considered a conflict of interest and it wouldn't stand. Now, let's also think about the relationship between the judge and the defendant. Remember, we've got no jury here. So the judge is the one who's going to determine whether the defendant is guilty. They're going to determine what the sentencing is. And so we could imagine if the situation was going to be like this, then people would wonder, they would ask the judge the question, like, what's your relationship with the defendant? If you've ever had to go to jury duty before, then you'll know. You get interviewed, and the attorneys will ask questions to see, does this person have any prejudices or preconceived notions or something in their minds that will cause them to already have an opinion on whether the person is guilty or innocent before the trial even takes place, right? And if they feel that a potential juror has a presupposition or something like that, then they'll throw them out. And so they get interviewed. And so if you're going to interview the judge in this case and say, well, do you know the defendant? All right, what do you know about the defendant? And here, since the judge is Jesus, right, if we've bowed a knee to Christ, then he would have to say, yes, actually, that's my brother. That's my sister. You know, she was adopted, yeah. And yeah, you know, he or she was always getting into trouble, but you know, I was always there for them. And in fact, you know what my dad had me do? I had to make a big sacrifice for them because I love them so much. I did this for them. There is no way that any court in America would let a relationship like that stand. But that is the relationship that you have with the judge if you have made Jesus as your Savior. The decision has already been made. We talked about this last week. The legal term being justified means we've already been found innocent. This is a done deal. That happened in the past. That happened on the cross some 2,000 years ago. So we have all these conflicts of interest that should give us confidence. We go before our courtroom scene here. If we'd made Jesus our Savior, things are going to go very, very well for us. We actually have many levels of assurance that things are going to go well for us. And it's worth taking some time to consider this because many people, even if they've been Christians for a long time, many people, I know many of you, are still worried about this outcome somehow. And part of that comes from a good place, right? When we realize how sinful our sin is, as Paul's been talking about in Romans up until now, as we realize, man, just how bad we really are, we don't feel worthy of what God has done for us. And if that's kind of how you're feeling, that's good. You recognize how serious all of this is, but we can take it to a sinful degree when we start wallowing in it and saying, well, you know, I'm just not good enough and not appreciating or recognizing what God has done for us. But our courtroom scene here shows how all of this can give us a great deal of assurance that we are going to be able to get into heaven someday if we are a Christian. All right? Think about our process here. We've got our defense attorney and the judge is the same person representing us, has already died for us, has already said you are justified, has already said this is a done deal, and has been predestined since before you were born. Then absolutely, we have a very good level of assurance here, right? God has already predestined us to not be guilty. But if all of this is not enough for us to be convinced that everything's going to work out okay, then we have this wonderful picture in the Bible of Paul. And we can see his courtroom scene playing out. And we can see all of this working with him. Paul went through this. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 12 to 17, Paul said, I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that he considered me trustworthy, appointing me to his service. Even though I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus." Paul gives us his qualifications here, and this is big. Right, I've talked to many people before who say, you know, I'm just not sure I can get to heaven, and we'll go over the plan of salvation and show exactly how all this works in the Bible and how it's clear, and I'll hear, "But Tim, you don't really know my past. You don't know what I've done. I've done some bad things." This is why Paul's testimony is so good here. Right, because here's Paul. He was running around persecuting, killing Christians or having them killed. The only reason that they were guilty of that brought this about was that they were serving the one true God. Right, whatever you did, it's not worse than this. Paul calls himself the chiefest of sinners. And yet, even with all of that going on, because of this particular arrangement, Paul says the grace of the Lord was poured out on him. What an amazing, amazing thing. He continues. He says, "Here's a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God be glory and honor forever and ever. Amen." Here's the process in action, right? Sometimes we sit back, we reflect on our lives, we realize how we're truly falling short of the glory of God, just as the Bible tells us we'd have, right? That's a fact, every single one of us. But we can get confused with how this courtroom scene is playing out, and we can just listen to the prosecuting attorney accusing us before God day and night and listen to that and say, you know what? He's right. I am guilty, guilty, guilty. And then we shut down. We consider ourselves unworthy of all of this, which we are. And then we don't participate anymore. We don't worship God properly. We're not excited about our faith anymore. We're worried about the outcome. When instead, we should focus on how all of this is playing out, how all of this is a done deal, and that in spite of all of our wretchedness, this thing, this wonderful gift of salvation, God has predestined us to be able to experience. It's all going to be good. This is where our joy should come from. So don't let these accusations rob us of our joy. And here's the second part where kind of everything comes together here with our chapter, verses 37 and 38. "No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." So what he's talking about here is eternal security. He's talking about the fact that the way that courtroom scene plays out, it's been predetermined from the beginning of time what the verdict is going to be, so you're not going to lose your salvation. You're not going to get tossed out of the court or ushered out of the bema seat and brought over to the great white throne judgment. It doesn't work like that. We've spent a couple Sundays the past few months talking about eternal security, so I'm not going to spend any more time talking about that this morning. But instead, I just want to focus on this phrase here that we read. And that is that we are more than conquerors. Right, Paul says we are more than conquerors. And so this is kind of a favorite passage for people to remember. There's, you know, books with this title. This is a very common thing for people to look at and get comfort from. And it's really a good phrase. It's a good comment. But what exactly does this mean? We are more than conquerors. What does Paul really mean by that? Obviously, it's good. Obviously, it's really good. But what's the perspective here? What's he trying to show us? When he says, more than conquerors, three words in our English. This is one word in the Greek, hypernikeo. And it's just a compound word, actually, of two Greek words kind of smashed together. Hyper, which is a word we know, exceeding, above normal. That's hyper, and then nikeo, overcome, or to conquer, or to prevail. And so this is exceeding one who conquers, exceeding one who prevails. And so this is a fascinating word choice here that Paul uses to describe those who have made Jesus their Savior. And it is, I would suggest, even just with this word, we are able to take a couple of steps back and look at all of these different pieces of the stained glass window that we talked about a couple of weeks ago. And now we see the complete image. Everything comes into focus now. We see a complete story, and now it makes sense. We are more than conquerors. What is a conqueror? A conqueror is someone who not only achieves victory, there's someone who achieves absolute victory. To conquer means you have won 100%. It is absolutely huge. And there's some very famous conquerors in history, and the reason why we know some of these names or they're so famous from so long ago is that it is rare for anyone to be able to achieve victories this large. So for the handful of people who have been able to achieve these things, they've captured the imagination of men and women throughout the ages, and so we know about them today. So famous ones, a good example, Alexander the Great. He was born a prince of Macedonia, and he was tutored by none other than Aristotle himself. By the age of 22, he conquered Greece, and he kept going. At the height of his empire, before he died, he managed to conquer, create an empire that stretched from Greece all the way over to northern India. And his legend was so great that Julius Caesar, Augustus Caesar, and Caligula were all noted to have gone to the place where he was buried, and they went to pay respect to his memory and pay homage to him there. Alexander the Great, a well-known conqueror. Here we have Genghis Khan. And this is a guy, great story here. He started with nothing. He's kind of from some royal line, but it was a lesser-known branch, and they were out of favor, and so he really started out with nothing. And he wound up conquering territories from Afghanistan all the way to northern China. And in fact, the empire that he put together was four times the size of Alexander the Great's. Genghis Khan was a conqueror. There's Attila the Hun, there's Charlemagne. You guys know these names, right? But the point is, becoming a conqueror requires such absolute victory that their exploits are still taught to children, in some cases, even thousands of years after they've been gone. These men are conquerors. And God says that in all these things that we've been talking about in Romans up until now, in all these things, you are so much more than any of these men ever were. We glory in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Romans 5, 3-5. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Romans 8, 28. As Christians, we're going to struggle in this life. We're going to suffer. Right? We've taken enough steps back. We can see the whole stained glass window now. We see the image that God is showing us, and what God's promise is that we're going to suffer. We're going to have trials. But God does not promise to help us escape from those things. It's not what Paul's been showing us. The stained glass window shows us that in the face of struggle, in the face of this suffering, we see a picture of victory. God helps us to triumph in these things. That's the stained glass window. Romans 8, 18. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. Because of all of these things, Jesus dying on the cross for us, Jesus' promise to come back for us, God working with us, the whole courtroom scene playing out in our favor, all of these amazing, amazing things that God has promised to do in us and through us, all those things considered up until now, no, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Now, my friends, it's Romans chapter 8, stained glass window that shows us the picture of everything that Paul's been putting together up until now in the book. Would you go ahead and close with me in prayer here? Father, we thank you so very much for giving us your word. We thank you for letting us study it. We thank you for all these different pieces of the picture that we've been looking at until now. And we thank you that we're able to take a step back and see how all these pieces fit together and see the plans that you have for us and recognize that they are good even when they may not feel so good. Lord, we thank you for this promise of the glory that will be revealed to us. We thank you that through these trials and through this suffering, you have promised we can be more than conquerors through the shed blood of your Son and the promise of his return. Lord, what an amazing, amazing thing you have set up for us. Thank you. Lord, thank you for choosing us. Thank you for allowing us to come to you. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for taking care of us. Lord, we just greatly appreciate it, and we know without you, without these things, we would have nothing. Lord, we also thank you very much that we have the opportunity to gather with our brothers and sisters after this service and enjoy a fellowship meal together. We ask that you would bless this food to our bodies, help us to glorify you with the energy we receive from it. We love you very, very much, God. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.